Buenas tardes. Vamos a dar comienzo a la sesión final de esta conferencia internacional sobre los museos de la seda. Y tras confirmar que no es posible la primera intervención, que era una exhibición audiovisual para temas de patrimonio similar a la que tuvimos ayer a primera hora de la tarde, tras no ser posible por un problema de tráfico, pues debemos comenzar con las dos ponencias principales de esta tarde, que cerrarán la conferencia. A mi derecha, Sophie de Gossier, de la Escuela de Altos Estudios en Ciencias Sociales de París, a la que yo daré en primer lugar la palabra. Y a mi izquierda, el profesor Klaus Nieberg, de Historia Económica de la Universidad de Estocolmo, Suecia, y además representando al Museo de la Seda, al Nieberg. Comenzaremos con la intervención. Las dos van a ser en inglés, por lo tanto lo digo para que ustedes puedan también hacer uso, quien lo necesite, de sus traductores. Comenzaremos con Sophie de Gossier, que para mí pues es un verdadero placer presentarla, porque nos ha ayudado, como ya dije en la inauguración, muchísimo en la preparación de la exposición de los museos de la seda en Francia. De hecho, es de todas las ponencias la única que tiene un formato territorial. Los museos de la seda en Francia, cuando en el resto de intervenciones que hemos visto nos estamos concentrando en museos específicos, concretos. ¿Por qué sucedió esto? Cuando empezamos a contactar con los museos franceses, había mucha dificultad, y esto es un problema que también mencioné en la inauguración, había mucha dificultad para que el personal de estos museos pudiera dejar su trabajo en dichos centros y trasladarse aquí 2 días para explicarnos sus actividades. No podían abandonar sus museos porque suponía cerrarlos para venir aquí. Y en consecuencia tuve la idea de encargar a la doctora de Gossier esta intervención, porque conozco además que ella es una de las principales expertas europeas en temas de textiles antiguos. Diría europeas y mundiales, porque he tenido ocasión de coincidir con ella y junto con la profesora Dominique Cardon, pues constituyen tal vez dos de las personas en Francia de mayor nivel para tratar estas cuestiones. Y le propuse algo que ella hizo generosamente, que fue visitar los museos de Francia de la seda que ella pudiera, y asumió ese reto, y no solo para hacer una ponencia síntesis que sin lugar a dudas va a ser muy interesante, sino especialmente porque en la exposición sobre los museos de la seda ha sido ella quien nos ha facilitado, en colaboración con los técnicos de los diferentes museos, nos ha facilitado fotografías, datos, información. Por lo tanto, Sophie, mil gracias por tu generosidad, por tu apoyo en esta iniciativa y por tu sensibilidad en este tema. Dicho esto, no me queda otra cuestión que darte la palabra y prestar atención a esta intervención, que sin lugar a dudas será de un enorme interés. Gracias.
Bueno, gracias a los colegas y a las instituciones que me han invitado a participar en este congreso, que es muy interesante y muy simpático. In February 2017, Germán Navarro and Ricardo Huerta asked me to present the situation of silk museums in France. Prison sericulture and reeling are not my field as such, given that my research deals mostly with silk weaving before the early modern period, that is to say between the beginning of the Common Era and the 16th century. I agreed to take the job, and eventually I am very grateful since the survey I have done has allowed me to take the measure of what happened in several regions and to meet people who have a real passion for sericulture and silk material. Claudio Zania's publications and the discussions that we had together about sericulture in Italy, so close to France during the 19th and 20th century at least, and even earlier, had already exposed to me many features of this long story and the possible parallels between the two countries on either sides of the Alps, of the mountains. I'm thinking on the research on silk, on silk moth that led to the setting up of the entomological collection of the Padua Ezeopolis Museum, and I learned also from the Museum in Tbilisi, as well as those of the Confluence Museum in Lyon, where a wonderful exhibition opened in 2009 on their cervical moth called the Wings of Silk. Also very inspiring was Françoise Claverol's anthropological research in the Cévennes during the 1980s and the 1990s, which evidenced the two inseparable sides of silk production. Both, I quote, an economic commitment, one of the main resources of that society, and a story of feelings, something that cannot be expressed easily. I close the bracket and I add something that cannot be expressed because of their sensual and emotional roots. Now I shall make a short geographical and historical context. Silk museums devoted to sericulture and reeling are scarce in France, so my job was not that big. They can be found in three regions, which are at the heart of the sericulture areas represented by Léon Clunier, in 1877, when the silkworm's breeding was just recovering from the dramatic pebrine epidemic. Clunier was open-minded, as he represented not only the region where the silk harvest is very significant, indicated by dense... Okay. So by dense, here I shall show the three different colors, indicated by dense green dots on a yellow flat tint, distributed in a large area that goes up along the Rhône River, reducing in width gradually. So it is all this region, like a triangle, around on each side of the Rhône River. But also, it represented the region where silk is a true actual industry, but of secondary importance. So it is this, and you can see on these areas and a little on the borders, indicated by green dots also, but of a lower density. And finally, he represented also regions reproducing very little silk, producing very little silk, and locations where sericulture was tentatively introduced, that are indicated with a yellow flat tint. The most important region and the most ancient where silk weaving and sericulture have been attested since at least the 13th century, and probably thanks to the Spanish weavers, is composed of the Cévennes. So it is this area below the massive central mountains and the right line near that close that through Nîmes. The two other regions are Ardèche, that extend a little north in that region, that extend from the Seven to the north of to Montélimar, and Drôme, which is on the east side of the Rhône River, almost in Provence. And that even if that map was drawn 140 years ago, Léon Clunier shows a large extension of sericulture areas which do not exist anymore. But it is a good, it was, I felt a good, well, it is a nice map to understand where, what the art of the region were, and that explain why some interesting places still exist. So three areas with more or less three centuries during they fed the silk weaving industry with raw material in Lyon, in Nîmes, some also abroad, and a local hosiery, well, silk knitting industry, that seems to be enduring today. The map shows also some pockets of sericulture present further north, around Montauban and Périgueux, and along the Loire Valley, around Angers and Tours, where King Louis the 11th established the first silk manufacture in 1470, entailing numerous efforts to develop local sericulture. Even though it represents a past situation, this map is an interesting entry point to introduce a few museums that I will present to you and that bear witness of this brilliant past. Those museums were found in direct connection with the movement of sericultural revival that started around the Cévennes in the last three decades of the 20th century. This revival is linked to the creation of the National Park of the Cévennes in September 1970, and it is a national park which is in that area. It is linked also to the developments of les chemins de la soie, the silk ways, as cultural itineraries within the European Cultural Roads Program, launched by the European Council in 1987. And to the figure of André Schenk, head of the sericultural station in Alès, and the instigator in 1948, in the wake of the Second World War, of the Permanent Commission of International Sericulture Congresses, and in 1955, of the International Sericultural Commission, ISC, which is still alive, its headquarters being located in India, in Bangalore, since 2013. Most of the silk museums I shall talk about were established many years ago in three regions clearly identified by Clunier. So the Seven, the South Ardèche that I showed on the map, but it's to remind and to put the name, the orthographical, how it is written, and the Provençal Drôme. In the Loire-Valais region, some initiatives are emerging with an important question to solve. I shall show you and ask you if you have an idea, an answer to my question. I will present them briefly before insisting on the major protagonists who have played a role in the Silk Museum's history. In this region, west of the Rhône Valley, which is the Cévennes, there are two museums dedicated to silk and sericulture. One is in Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort, and the other in Saint-Jean-du-Gard. In Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort, as you see here, the Silk Museum was established in 1984, by the Association for the Development of Sericulture in Cévennes, launched in December 1977 to revive local sericulture. Its collections originated from the Greffeuil Workshop, a production unit for reeling and weaving, then opened in the nearby Monoblet under Michel Costa's efforts. He was a student of André Schenk. He learned sericulture from André Schenk. Settled in a building owned by the municipality, it closed in 2011 and reopened in July 2013. After the municipality bought the collections to the association and made works to meet the safety standards. The museum is organized in three sections. A magnanerie. Magnan is a word for silkworm in Provençal language. And magnaneries are the buildings, the special buildings where they were bred. In this magnanerie, there is a complete cycle of silkworm breeding, which is conducted each year from April to October. Some wild silk moths are also occasionally raised. Here, hairy moth, and a panel on wild silks with interesting samples are part of the exhibition. A reeling section with material from former domestic and industrial workshops are also visible, with a video showing the activities in the region in the 1940s. The third section show warping and weaving. You see the machine here. And knitting, silk knitting machines, and a few silk stockings, legacy of the local specialty, maintained today at a high level by a few local companies. And these companies are well represented in the museum, and they have strong relation between the firms and the museum, and the museum sends the people, gives the addresses of the companies which are open to the public at certain hours so that they can visit the companies in parallel with the museum. So I add that because we spoke about that this morning. So the third section, the museum has also a room for children to engage in discovery activities, another for exhibitions of local creators, and a shop. Its budget balance is tight as the wages of the part-time three employees depend on the museum resources, and it is very difficult there too. Out of the museum, four discovery trails of the surroundings goes in the countryside and in the city of, in the village of Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort. And the provost as well as the addresses of this nearby company. The museum promotes also a young Parisian startup company. Here is the showcase in the museum. The company is called Cerisin. It has been founded in 2015 by a designer and an agricultural engineer, Clara Hardy and Constance Madol. Cerisin applied for a patent to make two- and three-dimensional objects produced directly by silkworms raised in Monoblet nearby, a few 10 kilometers from Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort. According to the press release, their technique focuses on a new material, the silk called cerisin, a non-woven silk, 100% natural, as shiny and light as organza, which inspires the most fancy fashion and interior decoration companies. They are very close to Hermès, for instance. For those who know sericulture, the idea of producing silk in the form of sheets belongs to the silkworms themselves. Those doing so in the past were called tapestry silkworms. But the startup has developed a specific technology to have them make directly design objects. Sevenol silk is not short of future prospect, and the Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort Silk Museum is a really welcoming and warm environment to initiate visitors to the wealth of local silk heritage. Its director, Muriel Berthaud, is a welcoming figure to understand the place. So we'll go to the second museum nearby, not far, well, 1 hour on the north of Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort, which is in Saint-Jean-du-Gard. Maison Rouge, Red House, translation, the Museum of the Seven Old Valleys. It is a very different museum set in a reeling factory of Grande Rouge, Large Red, well, it had a close name, but different, which closed in 1965. The museum opened last April, 6 months ago, after an ultra-modern building was added using local materials, such as shale stone and wares of chestnut wood, all founded by Alès Agglomeration, a consortium of 73 communes. It was originally built in 1838 with great care and at the avant-garde of progress, with a windmill and a tea house in the park. Well, Ricard explained that yesterday. Here is a windmill, you see, and it was from allowing to take water from the underground. Only on the, there was something on the top that you see on the right, on the top of the tower, that was working with the wind, which is well one of the ancestors of the same kind of apple today. It was in the vicinity there was also an artificial lake and a large mulberry plantation. You see here a map. Sorry, there is my figure in the, because there was a window over the map. So when I took the picture, visible in the picture. For these, all these regions and this interest, the place is listed in the, by the French Historic Monument Society, which is a very important list in France. Alès agglomeration runs Red House with the help of a steering committee made up of the main institutional partners and a scientific committee in which state, regional, and departmental cultural services sit. Sericulture and reeling are presented in the historic building with regional, well, you see here the sericulture and cocoons waiting on the top, and then, well, photos that you have seen yesterday, and the reeling part on the bottom. But something new is that there are in the back of the room some regional garments that are presented, and an exceptional collection of locally made ancient silk stockings. You see, it is absolutely, I could not believe when I saw these in the drawers, the imagination that they had in the 19th century to, well, stockings, silk stockings that you wear. And there are still these factory around, well, not making the same, but, and, yes, because, well, as I explained, it was a specialty of the region. And they have also a book of models and documentation from the companies. The new building presents the other part of the collection, of a huge collection of 30,000 artifacts accountable for the various activities of the Cévenol Valleys and the characteristic features of their identity. There are parts on the building, built environment, the bread tree, which is a chestnut tree, which is very important because people in this area, which was a poor area, people were living on the on bread made with chestnut, with chestnuts. Which were baked in bread. Also the golden tree, which is the mulberry tree, in fact, because it brought a lot of money in the area when they began to grow them and to educate silkworms. And well, as I use the word educate, in the region, they don't grow, they don't raise silkworms. They educate silkworms as they do with their children. So there is a strong feeling, a strong emotional relation with the silkworms, and I believe that it exists in many other places. And also some religious history focusing on the Protestantism, which was very important in the region. The museum has also an exhibition space, a conference room, a pedagogical space for children, as in the other museums, and it organizes meetings with artists, applied artists, designers, storytellers, musicians, and acrobats. Well, it is a cultural center of the city, in fact. It became so. Of course, it doesn't deal only with silk, but with all the cultural aspects of the Savonarole Valleys, but it is also an interesting place for silk culture. Its collections are intimately related to the passion of a man. Which is on the left, you have the chestnut, the different types of chestnuts that were grown there. And on the right, you have a cupboard which has been made, carved in a chestnut trunk. And by the way, I was very surprised because I found exactly the same piece of furniture in the Modenese Apennines in Italy 2 months before, where they have also lots of chestnuts and also where they grew a lot of silk, of mulberry and make silk. Its collections, these collections are intimately related to the passion of a man for his region. Daniel Travier, who spent 50 years collecting Savonarole artifacts of high quality. Well, there is not an object in the museum which is not high quality, which is not a piece of popular art. It's really unbelievable, but yeah, it is not any collection of ethnography. It's really art, popular art. With Françoise Claverolle, the person, the colleague, the anthropologist I spoke at the beginning, Michel Costa, who was at the beginning of the Saint-Hippolyte-du-Fort Museum, the anthropologist and filmmaker Marc-Henri Pio, and a few others, Daniel Travier took part into this project of the Silk Roads that I talked about earlier. So now we'll go to the Ardèche region, which is a little north from the Seven in this region. In Lagorce, in the Vallon-Pont d'Arc region, which is a very touristic area because of this beautiful landscape, the Verassois Silkworm Manianry Museum stands in a house for silkworms raising built in the 1840s and renovated between 2008 and 2015, so very recently, the same as the other museums, with a cultural and heritage project run by the municipality. The museum's collections are partly constituted by those of a previous museum, My Manianry, established in the 1960s at the very touristic site of Vallon-Pont d'Arc and in close to the Ardèche River gorges. Besides the expected sections on sericulture and reeling, including a living section, from April to September, as in lots of, almost all the other museums, the Lagos Museum presents a moth room to discover the diversity of silks existing in nature and the specific characters of the Bombyx mori. The museum has a very active cultural program directed to children and to a large public, conferences, exhibitions, and at night, exhibition and at night, a search for moth, as those producing cocoon silk are nocturnal. Incidentally, Lagos mayor, I discovered it sometime afterwards, is Hervé Ozil, a photographer and anthropologist also involved in the Silk Roads program that I have mentioned before. So they are all related, and it is a team, a group of people belonging to the same team 30 years ago that made the strong, the basis for these museums. Three additional museums, geographically close to Vallon-Pont-d'Arc, are dedicated to other topics, including a living sericulture section in their presentation. They are open from April to September, when there are the leaves on the mulberry trees and when they can raise the silkworms. Well, the buildings are beautiful. In La Bastide de Vitrac, it is the Château des Roures, a gorgeous castle of the late 15th century, recently restored. In L'Argentière, it's an old 19th century mill on the river, the Moulinet, small mill, silk museum in Ardèche. It has a section on throwing also, not only, which is not included in the other museums of the region. A third place, but I have no illustration for it, is in Saint-Alban-Auriol. It is a house, the Mas de la Vignasse. It is the maternal house of Alphonse Daudet, with a well-known 19th century regional writer. It includes two, but in another part, but it is present because it appeals to tourists, a silk raising living section. So we go back to the Clunier map to locate the Drôme area here on the east of the Rhône River, and Tolignan, of which you have already heard, which is east of Montélimar. I have not very many photos because I had no time to go there. Close to the Workshop Silk Museum has been established in 2001 at the initiative of the communal authorities again, who bought the collection of a private museum stored since 1985 in the building of an ancient reeling and throwing silk factory in a nearby commune called Montboucher-sur-Jabron. The new museum is now in an extension of the town hall at the center of the village. The collections had been gathered together by Pierre Lançon from a family involved in silk throwing, but I have not been able to understand if there was any relation between him and the people from Cévennes, which is not so far. The museum presents not only sericulture and reeling, but and weaving, but also throwing as a living heritage, thanks to the silk the living heritage since the silkworm raising section. And it demonstrates all the machines are operative, so they make demonstrations of how it works. And it shows some collection of silk garments. A video film shows the village's past tie to silk, because there were lots of throwing factories, about 20 firms in this small town or big village. On the difficult life, they insist on the difficult life of women workers in residential factories, as we saw yesterday when we heard about this question. So back to the Clunier map. I forget. Until this year, there was another museum in Drôme, Saillant, but it close to Tolignan. But I could not get any information. I was told that it was closed a few months ago. So it was related to a restaurant, and I think that it was difficult to have both the restaurant and the silk raising section. So now we'll go to a completely new area in a certain way. Well, not completely, because it existed in the past, but a region which is not very often taken into consideration when it is a question of sericulture. A few green, yellow, small areas show these far from the southern regions have kept traces of their sericultural past. A few places try to build some touristic activities on architectural remains interpreted as specific for silkworms raising. The focal points are the allegedly 16th century towers at the center of two villages east of Tours, Athée-sur-Cher and Azay-sur-Cher, shaped as circular two-story towers. These buildings are considered as magnanaries because of their interior setting with multiple cells interpreted as small spaces for the Bombyx mori and the mulberry leaves. Well, I look at the picture, well, I have not visited the place, but when I look at the picture, I am thinking more about pigeon places, birds for birds. But there is nowhere to go, well, from what is said, there is no window, there is no opening to allow them to go in and out. I have not found any historical evidence of these cells used for silkworms raising, but the hypothesis has been considered as serious in the region. So, I address the question to the audience if any of the colleagues present today knows about such buildings with series of cells used for sericulture in other areas. I would be very grateful, very interested to know about the existence of such places. I'm not, I accept one and the other. I have nothing to help me for the moment to understand if this is true or not. At any rate, several tourist venues presenting rooms bearing such series of cells exist in the Loire Valley region, and mainly with troglodyte, which is a troglodyte area with lots of troglodyte buildings, because of the easily workable quality of the tufo stone, which is there. The Brézé Castle, a monumental castle museum of the mid-16th century, south of Saumur, so it is much more on the west, is well known for its 1 kilometer galleries, underground galleries, where rooms for living and working have been carved. The presence of one room with the same series of cells than in the Ate and Aze towers has led to adding this room, presented as a magnanery, to the tour of the galleries. There is a similar situation in a private troglodyte house in the village of Bourré, close to the two towers, which encourage its owners to be trained in sericulture. That's how it begins again. And to open their house for visitors, for its troglodyte structure first, and second for the sericulture demonstrations. They call the place site troglodyte of the Bourré Magnanerie. So as if, well, but maybe, well, I'm open to comparisons. Sericulture is popular with tourists. None of these Loire Valley places may be considered as an actual silk museum. But I was interested to ask the question about the underground series of cells that look redundant and that I have been unable to interpret so far. So the question I'm asking for your answers afterwards when we have the common talk. So I will finish. I would like to speak a little more on the leading figures that I introduced in the beginning. Besides the Silk Museums themselves, this survey has been enriched by the participation of people who, in the Seven and in South Ardèche, have taken part into the revival movement of the 70s and 80s of the 19th century. Their solidarity seems to have borne fruits. The most important museums existing today, well, about silk, along but also independently of tourism development, have been erected for their actions and collections. In the shadow, but close to this group of people, is another team of specialists who have shared their knowledge with them. I already mentioned them, well, in particular, André Schenk, who was a technical advisor of the group of people, of young people, who were in charge of the establishment of, albeit slow, of most of the present Silk Museum. The La Mulatière Cerical Station, which was after the Alès Cerical Station, and the, more or less in the same wave as the one in Mercia that we heard about yesterday, where the ICSC was located, later under the direction of Henri Bouvier and Gérard Chavancy, from 1980 to 2012, when it was closed by the INRA. Well, like in Murcia, it is an agricultural program, development program, still operates more or less in the shadow of one person, Bernard Mauchamp, who is still there. He was a former director of the station, and he is a technical advisor of the Sericine startup company. He is still raising silkworms. I don't know, maybe he's 80 or 85 years old, still raising silkworms for cultural events. I talked with him last Monday, but he had very little time because there is a steel market this weekend in Lyon, and he was preparing his series of silkworms. To conclude, there are only a handful of silk museums in France, but they are interesting structures. They question the special character of silk raising noted by Françoise Claverolle. First, its economic contribution to a better life for people in areas where life was difficult in the past as well as today. As I noted, the Silk Museum have a difficult life today, but they are contributing to the development of tourism. And second, I think also to the sensual and emotional motives that in the South brought people together to revive this activity and today to share it with a large public. As an extension, do I have some more time? Still no? Yes? So I wanted only to show you a little more than what I showed you until now, because the map that I showed you is just the left corner, below corner, lower corner of this huge map designed by Léon Clunier in that year of 1877, and it shows the whole world. And well, I was interested to show it to you because you come from different countries. I am absolutely not sure that it was, well, for France, it looks that it was quite okay, but well, I have better maps. Well, it more or less shows like what you said this about the sericulture in the region, in the Iberian Peninsula at the end of the 19th century, but maybe there are some places that are not represented. And here is Italy and Turkey. Well, it was to show you what had been done. And well, I am ready to hear about lots of critics because he had 1 year to make it. Thank you.